This is your The Joe We Never Got to Know Leader Fan Radio Network.
Okay.
And KFAN.com. 1 minute, 21 seconds past the hour, 3 o'clock. That is Central Daylight Time. We welcome you back to a Monday production of the Bumper to Bumper program on a fairly moist Monday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. I am the host of the program. My name is Dan Barrero. Guardzi is the producer and sidekick of the show. We will be with you all the way until 6:30 this very evening. Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line is open. 646-86. I'll ask the most important question early. Who was the first on-air personality to leave Rube Party last Friday night? Forgotten Star Brewing. Who was it?
I believe it was Dan the Common Man Cole.
He kind of confirmed that.
Yes.
And then, did you hear the story about he ended up having to stay an extra half hour?
I did hear
his car was boxed in.
It was, yeah.
That's too good.
Abbott was basically the valet guy that had four or five sets of keys to try to move everybody out.
I was told you closed the place.
No, I did not. You stayed longer than I did.
I stayed, I want to say, I was there to at least 9.
That's about when I left.
It might have been 9:30-ish. So I can't be, I wasn't at the top of the list. Who was second? If Common was first, was PA second?
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably, although after the car meltdown, it might have been you or I.
Yeah.
Because I mean.
That's true.
Everybody kind of stayed until the band played, and then we were out.
I had to stay at least long enough to see Marnie Gellner just light up the stage with her dancing ability and her, she, you know what they talk about entertainers? The best ones use the entire stage.
Yes.
She did.
She does.
I don't remember what song it was, or maybe it was a couple songs, but she was definitely on her A game for sure. Thank you, as I mentioned yesterday, to all the Rubes who stopped by to see us for Rube Party 2024. The next one, I guess, is slated for 2030.
Is that right?
6 years.
Nice.
Because it had been 5 years since the last one. Is that true?
That's true.
I think the next slated Rube Party is for 2030. I don't know why those kinds of gaps exist, but that's what I was told.
One thing that you and I need to file away, and I've already told a few people in the office that we need to remember if and when we ever get, as my dad would call it, static for the TV show, Enough Said, Fridays on Fox 9.
Yes.
I don't know if this happened to you, but it happened to me multiple times at the Rube Party at Forgotten Star. People came up and said, we did a reverse Guardzi and Barrero. We watched you on TV and then realized that you had a radio show, and now we listen to the radio show every day.
Well, here's the key to that.
And I loved it.
Is it? I heard that as well. Did we literally hear from the same three people?
I doubt it.
Or were there like hundreds of people?
At least dozens.
Dozens of people.
At least dozens.
Yeah, it was a nice change, wasn't it?
Yes.
And the percentage, if you go back in Rube Party history, I think the earliest Rube Parties, the percentage of male to female was, I think, like 9.5 to 1.
It was, yeah.
And now, I'm not saying it's 50-50, but what would you, I mean, there were a lot of women in the crowd.
Yes.
So I can't believe it's just, they're going because they're being dragged there.
The plus ones.
I'm not buying that at this point. They seem to get the bit.
Yes.
They seem to know it. They seem to be familiar with all of us. So that's good. That's
awesome.
A very good sign.
It was a very good party.
For sure. It went very well start to finish. There'll be a lot of Joe talk on this show today. Certainly related to Joe Biden, the big news breaking over the, it broke after, I think it broke at towards the end of worst case scenario.
Yes.
Is when the story broke. So I didn't get to it at all yesterday because it hadn't happened yet. And now it's happened and it will be a big part of the discussion today that Joe Biden has, of course, most of you now know, stepped aside. The other Joe I want to get to, and we may not spend as much time on this because we have for several other shows, is one other aspect to the Joe Mauer story. Mauer now officially has been inducted into the pro basketball. He probably could have.
He's
such a good athlete.
He could play.
The Baseball Hall of Fame. I believe he was the last speaker.
He was.
As well. So technically, he was the last one inducted of the, how many was it total? Four or five?
Four.
Four. And the speech, I'd say, was kind of classic Joe.
Yes, it was.
Not great. It was, it was kind of formulaic, but that's Joe. He's not going to change. Not suddenly going to become Mr. Personality.
Wasn't going to be Marnie Gellner up there on stage.
That's for sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've talked a lot about, well, why do people in this town, at least some people have had, even fans, had difficulty warming to him the same way they have with some other players, especially when you factor in the historic nature of his numbers at the catcher from the catcher position. And we've laid out some of that having to do with when he got the contract, the breakout home run season, the feeling that, okay, now he's going to become a power hitter, and he never really was from that point forward. But you know another big piece of it, which I think over the years we have discussed before, we didn't get to know Joe in the postseason. There's no postseason Joe myth material, right? Like there is with Kirby Puckett. Like there is with Kent Herbeck, right? Like there is with Jack Morris. Somebody texted yesterday, some snarky individual, when I was talking a little bit about Joe, and said, Joe Mauer finished his postseason career with one more run batted in than Jack Morris.
Wow.
And I said, man, that's vicious, wow. First of all. And then I got to thinking, how many runs batted in did Jack Morris have as a hitter? And it turns out he had zero. So the bit is, Joe had one. He had one, you know.
Is basically, that true?
Yes, one run
wow.
batted in.
That's crazy.
Nothing, I mean, if you look at his overall stats, he had one, the 2009 year, that was his MVP year, right?
Yes.
5-for-12, that was his one good postseason, but it only lasted three games, obviously. He was 5-for-12, but for his career, .275 batting average, 11 hits, 10 singles, and one double. Nothing happened. Now, that's not all his fault. But I really do believe, and by the way, for the record, and this might be the most shocking part about it, he struck out 7 times. That's high for him, isn't it?
It is.
48
yes.
bats?
Yes.
So as I mentioned, 4 walks, 1 run batted in, and you can't even say, well, there was this remarkable defensive play he made. I mean, he may have made a couple of nice ones, but there was no, like, Puckett against the plexiglass or, you know what I'm saying? So I think
the signature moments.
Yeah. Play, yeah. And again, he's not the only great baseball player that didn't do any much or in the postseason. There's some great baseball players who never even got to the postseason, Ernie Banks included. The guy I grew up worshiping never even got to the postseason. But I do think that also factors in. It's much easier to have that sort of built-in appeal. If you can say, God, you remember when Mauer did such and such? And let's face it, Mauer's most significant postseason moment was the double that was taken away from him,
yeah,
right?
That's the Phil Cuzzi
yep. missed down the, was it the left? I think
left
the left
field.
Well, it had to be left field line. Come Joe, on. What am I talking about?
Come on, man.
I'm going to turn on the ball. But don't you think that's a significant
yes,
part of it?
Totally.
Is there just, because we've had in baseball some significant postseason success. It's gone back a ways, but we've had it going back to two World Series teams, and that changes everything. It even makes you think more highly of lesser players. Because those memories are etched in time or in your memory forever and ever. And there's nothing on Joe. There's nothing.
So much
we didn't get to know him in the postseason.
That the like Jack Morris, for example, he was a Veterans Committee Hall of Famer, if I remember right. He didn't get in with the writers, if I remember correctly.
I think that might be correct.
Somebody can correct it. But my point is, for all of us here in Minnesota, it seems preposterous that Jack Morris wasn't going to be in the Baseball Hall of Fame.
That's correct.
Like, how do you not, just because of what he did, forget about the Game 7 stuff, which here is obviously mythic, but then he went on to win a couple more with Toronto. He won one with Detroit, too, right? Back in the 80s?
That's correct.
So we always were like, man, that makes no sense. Now, with Joe, as we talked about last week and on the TV show, we were all kind of like, I don't know, is he? Is he not? Because what we associated with, like whether it was Kirby or whether it was Jack, and, you know, Paul Molitor and Dave Winfield obviously had their runs, too, as the Twins, you know, Hall of Fame representatives. It was a lot easier for us to make that case. With Joe, it was a little bit not as much because we didn't have and plus his personality was not like a Puckett, which whose was, but you never felt like he was letting you in. You said it famously all the time. Kirby let you in for the whole ride, and it felt like you were there with him, and that's what made him so popular.
And Joe, we were lucky to get something was pretty neat out of him. That's pretty neat.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be the most, or it's frustrating if it didn't go so well.
Real frustrating.
This is a big day on the fan. This is our taste for the tour day. That's because today is the big event that Garzy is emceeing again at Interlochen Country Club. This has been a yearly event we've talked about a great deal. This is the 6th annual taste for the tour. Money raised this year goes to the TB1 Fund, Emergency Food Assistance Program Fund as well. Let me give you a little more detail on the TB1 Fund. It is named after Braxton Battaglia, a young girl diagnosed in 2019 with B-cell acute lymphoblastic leukemia, and her village of supporters called Team Brax. The TB1 Fund's primary goal is to help patients at M Health Fairview Masonic Children's Hospital focus on recovery by providing items and experiences that not only distract and engage them, but also encourage recovery, be it mental, physical, or emotional. I'm bringing this up to know if you want to help us today, and we appreciate any of your generosity, this is where your money is going to go. It's going to go to the Emergency Food Assistance Program Fund, which is specifically tailored to provide immediate relief for patient families during their time at M Health Fairview Masonic Children's Hospital. Contributions to EFAPF will be used to provide essential assistance to patient families, including access to food pantries, cafeteria credits, provisions for bedside meals for families, and assistance with grocery and other out-of-pocket food costs. This celebrity list at this event is obviously always huge. Bobby Bell, Matt Boldy, Rebecca Brunson, Tatum Everett, Derek Falvey, PJ Fleck, Herbie, Ben Lieber, Randall McDaniel. It goes on and on. We'll get to some of the other names a little bit later. As I said, Gardzi is the MC again. This is your second or third straight year?
Second
consecutive year. And on days like this, we also get access to individuals who are affiliated with this program. They want to raise awareness with it. And at 5 o'clock, we'll be joined once again by Bob Costas, who joined us last year. And when we come back, we get another visit with our good friend Tony Dungy. Real quick, the website for people, if indeed they're already interested in trying to contribute, can you help me there?
Taste for the Tour, F-O-R-E, as in golf, with the 3M Open, obviously. TasteForTheTour.com. And if you want to win $1,000, we've got that for you, TheFanAndBigDeck.com. Want to help you with our national cash contest. First keyword of the week is Bills. Go to KFAN.com and enter the keyword Bills.
Oh. Well, on Taste for the Tour Day, it's almost become tradition to chat with our next guest, who really doesn't, at this point, need much of an introduction. Tony Dungy, kind enough to join us via the Connecticut Water Systems Hotline. Tony, how are you, sir?
Hey, I'm doing well, Dan. How are you?
We're doing well. We're hanging in. We're just trying to stay, you know, ahead of the posse, Tony. You know, sooner or later, okay, they're going to come. They're going to come for us. But actually, you don't know that feeling, do you? Were you ever fired as a head coach?
My posse a couple of times.
Yeah, I guess that's true. But not lately, right? That's for sure.
Not lately.
It's good to chat with you. Remind our audience, because, you know, the Taste for the Tour event has become huge. But you go all the way back to, I think, the beginning for you was the taste of the NFL stuff, right? With Wayne, yeah, et cetera. Give us your history, how you got
Wayne,
hooked
yes
up. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, my son is 32 now, and I think he was just born. Super Bowl was out in L.A., and Wayne talked about doing this, and we can help hunger all over the country, and we can get some NFL people involved. And I was a young assistant coach with the Vikings, and I said, sure, let's do it. So it was a lot of fun, and it's been great to watch it grow and just see the benefits that have come to people over the years.
It's become enormous, as you said. The star-studded list that will be at Interlochen Country Club's huge. Although, and you could, as a guy who still has to travel some, could probably appreciate this, computer meltdown that froze,
wow,
our airline,
yeah,
system. Apparently, it's still affecting Delta flights, and there's some individuals who are having some difficulty getting in here, apparently.
Yeah, my son was actually flying on Delta the next day, the Saturday, and there were a lot of delays and people. He ended up getting there about 3 hours late, but I just see the horror stories of people staying, yeah, in the airport overnight and things, and it's just tough. So hopefully we bounce back from it and keep going, and we can get everybody there.
It's time, man. It's training camp time already, as I don't have to tell,
yeah,
you. In fact, Vikings rookies reported, I think yesterday, began working out today, and the head coach and the general manager also spoke to the media today. You know, we haven't talked about this, I don't think. And maybe I already know your view and forgotten it. But the big talk here, obviously, Tony, this offseason has been the decision to finally move up in the draft a little bit and use that opportunity to get a quarterback, maybe a quarterback of the future. There are a lot of them available. They end up with J.J. McCarthy. What are your impressions of him and what you think he might be at this level?
Well, I like J.J. a lot. I liked him as a winner and a leader at Michigan. When you win a national championship, that tells you something. And I know Kevin and the staff and Kwesi did a lot of research into quarterbacks. And who do you think can be your leader for the next 10 years? And they decided on J.J., so I'm willing to wait and see if they were right. It's tough when you select quarterbacks. I remember going back to before I got to Indianapolis, and it was Peyton Manning or Ryan Leaf, and it looks like now a slam dunk decision, but I can tell you at that time it was not. It went down to the 11th hour. So we're not going to know for a couple of years, but I like where they are, and I think J.J. working with Kevin O'Connell is going to be great.
Tony, one of the most embarrassing moments of my career was when we were debating on the radio that draft, my saying, yeah, Peyton's nice, he's going to be fine, but that Leaf guy, he's got that little extra edge. There's something about him. He's a winner. Obviously, that proved not to be the case.
Well, you were wrong, but you weren't alone. And I'll tell you what, it wasn't 80-20. You weren't out there in left field. It was 60-40 or 55-45. There were so many people saying Ryan Leaf has the upside. He's got the potential. Peyton's as good as he's going to be. He's had all this training his dad, and, you know, he's maxed out. So it went down to the final day with Indianapolis. I can tell you that.
That's fascinating. What is that? It's interesting. That was a long time ago, but what does it tell you about this process? No matter how thorough it gets and how scientific it gets and how systematic it gets, about why it's still, even then and even today, possible to swing and miss spectacularly. Why is it so difficult to figure out projecting players, especially quarterbacks?
Well, it's not foolproof. Number one, guys are a product of the system they're in. And then number two, they still are beholden to the system they go into. And as great as Peyton, and I tell you, Peyton Manning is the greatest player I've been around. But I can say this, had he gone to San Diego and Ryan Leaf gone to Indianapolis, it may have been different. Mm-hmm. Ryan Leaf goes there. They have four or five different coaches, different systems, different players. Peyton goes 15 years. He's got Tom Moore in the same offensive system. He's got Marvin Harrison, Edgerrin James, you know, Marshall Faulk, Reggie Wayne, Dallas Clark. Cast of all-stars and possible Hall of Famers. And if you put Leaf in that system with that quarterback coach and that offensive system and those players, I'm not sure he doesn't do really well.
Fair point, yeah. And, you know, it's interesting because a lot of the discussion here about how quickly to put McCarthy on the field has centered around that concern that maybe there have been some not great quarterbacks, but quarterbacks who could have been better than their reputation if they'd not been thrown to the wolves, so to speak, quite as quickly as they were, or if there was greater, to your point, maybe infrastructure around them as well. How do you thread that needle? How does a coaching staff, and you could say a general manager, thread the needle on, okay, now it's time, for example, because everybody, they've all declared it. We know McCarthy is the quarterback of the future. The issue is, you know, we don't want to do something that we're going to regret forever in going to him too soon. How do you know when the time is right?
Well, I do think a lot of that depends on the makeup, the maturity, and the inner drive of that quarterback. Peyton has told me that year playing, his first year when they were 3-13, and he set an NFL record for rookie interceptions and all the heartbreak and heartache that he went through, he said that was the best year for him. Now, some people can't deal with that. And some people, that type of year is going to break them. And when people say you're a bust and you know, you don't look like the same guy we saw in college. But for Peyton, the learning was great. And he was, I don't want to say, how would you put it, steady enough, determined enough that I don't care. People can criticize me. I know what I'm learning, and I'm going to be fine. The next year they're 13-3, and he goes to the playoffs, you know, 10 or 11 times in a row from there. But for some guys, that is going to break them, and you've got to know, can I put this guy in? He's going to struggle. If I play JJ, he's not going to look like he did at Michigan. We're going to lose some games that maybe we won with another quarterback. He'll benefit from it eventually if he can handle it. That's what the coaching staff has to decide.
I believe you've been out of coaching now. Is it 16 years? Was it last year, 2000? 16 years.
Yeah.
So we probably have talked about this before over the years, but we haven't in a while. For you, was it took 5 minutes to get past it? Was it 5 years to get past it? I mean, what was the approach for you mentally to get past that important part of your life and career?
Dan, I coached for 28 years, and I made a decision that was it for me. And fortunately, I had something else to do. I had other things, charity work in Tampa and family and everything. And then I was able to get on with NBC where I could stay involved part of the time, be around guys, still do interviews, still know what was going on, but I wasn't living it 24/7. For me, I never looked back and didn't have any regrets about leaving at 53 years old.
That's impressive because, as you know, for some people, man, it's not like a snap of the fingers. Why did it work that way for you? I mean, why did you have that kind of resolve? Did you feel like, I got nothing left, I'm just burned out on this, or what made it so simple for you?
No, my parents instilled in me, Dan, growing up, that your work, your job, it's what you do. It's not who you are. Mm. You have to have other things that determine who you are. Chuck Noll, my first coach with the Steelers, in the very first meeting I was ever in, he was so much like Bud Grant. Hey, welcome to the National Football League. It's a business. It's your profession right now, but don't make it your whole life. If you make football your whole life, you're going to be disappointed. So you've got to find some other things. And I did that. And I had some other things in mind, and I was ready to go. I enjoyed the 31 years I spent in the NFL, but it was time to do something else.
So you mentioned NBC. Are you back at it, regular schedule? What's your schedule going to be like for the upcoming season?
We will start in September, right after Labor Day. Mm-hmm. We actually have the Packers and the Eagles in Brazil. My first game. I do go to the game sites now. I was in the studio for a long time last year. They moved me to the game sites. It's been fun. It's been neat to see, talk to the players, talk to the coaches, talk to the fans. So I'll have 20 straight weeks once we start where my weekends are tied up. But I'll be enjoying it and looking forward to it.
Yeah, and do you like that switch? I mean, get it, because it gets you out, like you said, which maybe is good in a way, but it also means, I assume, a lot more travel.
It is more travel. I love being with the fans and interacting with the players and the coaches. What I miss is when I was in the studio, we got to watch every game and comment on every game and talk about the league. Now I don't get to do that as much. And I do miss that, but I really enjoy coming to the games and being part of that night of activity.
And when you talk to players, talk to coaches, and you stay connected to the game, obviously, because you have to stay as informed as you are, do you sense, I mean, how much do you think coaching has changed since you got out? Do you think it's still basically the same? Do you buy the notion that, well, younger players, they're used to, you know, sort of not being challenged the same way? You got it. It's a more delicate art these days than maybe it was then, or going back even further to the 2000s or 1990s. What do you see? What do you observe?
No, I think coaching is the same. I think these players need to be coached. I think they want to be coached. And I think you see that coaching makes a difference. And you see Bill Belichick, you know, continue to have success. You see Andy Reid continue to go to Super Bowls and win with that old school mentality. Now, can someone come in? Sean McVay comes in with a different approach, younger. Yeah, that can work too. But it all is connecting with the players, gaining their trust, letting them know that you're there to help them be the best that they can be, and then being the leader, leading that organization. And whether it's Andy and old school and we're going to practice in pads and we're going to have tough training camps, or whether it's Sean McVay coming in and saying, hey, this is the way we're going to do it now. And it's totally different. You've got to get the players to believe in you and to be unified. And if you do that, you're going to win.
Two last things for you. How surprised, if at all, were you that Kirk Cousins ended up signing elsewhere, that the Vikings did not continue to try to find a way to make it work here? What did you make of that move by Cousins?
I was a little surprised, given the fact that the players really responded to Kirk. They liked him. He was a leader. I do understand the business side of it when you're talking about that much money and that long-term commitment. That the Vikings maybe said, you know, we're better off kind of retooling and starting over. But I just thought the chemistry he had with that offense and the fact that they were close. Wasn't a team that was, okay, we had our down cycle down. We're headed out of the playoffs. This was a team that was close. So it was a little surprising.
Last item, Justin Gard, the producer of this show, who's emceeing the big event tonight, is heading out to the Big Ten media football stuff, I think, in Indianapolis. Can you, as an all-time Big Ten guy, can you even recognize the landscape when it comes to college sports, man? It's crazy, isn't it?
It is, and the whole thing, Dan, I'm hopeful for college football, but I really have my doubts. I have a 17-year-old son who went through the recruiting process on a small level. He ended up going to Butler. But just talking to coaches and this whole thing, NIL and transfer portal, and coaches are telling him, hey, we like your film, but we've got to see who on our team is going to stay and who's going to leave. We've got to see what transfers we get in. We can't offer you until we find out what's going on. And this NIL portal, the whole thing. And then, yes, switching to geography. My older son went to Oregon, and now for them to be in the Big Ten is just unbelievable to me. I don't know how to process it.
I think it's really difficult, especially for those of us who remember the way it was. I know, you know, things change, and some maybe there'll be progress here, but I don't know. I always viewed, especially college football, as one of the things about it was the geography, right? Was you associated certain programs with certain areas.
Rivalry.
Right, exactly. and obviously the money is what's made some decisions be made, that even if it comes at the expense of those kinds of deals. Always a pleasure to catch up with you, sir. Thank you for the time. Have a wonderful 2024 season. Tony, hopefully we'll chat with you during it at some point.
Thank you, Dan. I'd love to. And tell Justin, I hope the event goes just super tonight. And I know he'll do a great job, but it's really, really an event that benefits so many people. And I just hope the people in Minnesota can get out and support it.
Thanks for the participation, the help, my friend. I appreciate you.
All righty, Dan. Good to talk to you.
Good to talk to Tony Dungy at all times. And he's talking about the Taste for the Tour event, which Gardzi is hosting tonight at it's a sold out event at Interlochen, but you can help. And in this case, we're trying to raise money it's the Emergency Food Assistance Program Fund, the TB1 Fund, where you help provide essential assistance to patient families, including access to food pantries, cafeteria credits, provisions of meals for families staying by their child's bedside. That's the whole deal here at the Minnesota Health Fairview Masonic Children's Hospital. And I'm reminded a $10 contribution can fund a cafeteria voucher for dinner. $100 can provide a full week of meals for a family member. $200 can provide a week's worth of food for one floor's food pantry. So any way you can help, any bit that you can help, please do so. And the website again, Gardzi?
TasteForTheTour.com, for as in F-O-R-E. And you can make straight donations. You can bid on the KFAN item, which is 4 lower-level tickets to Vikings-Packers December 29th. And then they've got the entire silent auction right there online, including a couple of different Taylor Swift suites.
Really?
Now, those are 150 grand, so you're going to have to grab like 30 people, but they've got the usual silent auction items that you would imagine in terms of autographed helmets, in terms of dining experiences, in terms of you know, framed autographed pictures, things like that. I think you got the Rat Pack a couple years ago. Remember, you were
That's correct.
You were in on the bidding there. So they've got a lot of great stuff. So even obviously the event's sold out, you can't go to it. But if you want to just donate, or if you want to bid on some stuff, it's super easy to do it at tasteforthetour.com. And breaking news that you don't even know about yet, because it just got confirmed within the last 10 minutes. A little less than 1 hour from now, Jeff Bridges will join
He's back again?
He's back. Jeff Bridges.
Holy
moly. We're basically running back to 2023
That's good. That's pretty
good. Only thing different this week is I don't think A-Rod's coming in studio this week. Remember last year? We had the Taste for the Tour Day. Then we had A-Rod in studio. Yeah. I'm in an RV in the Black Hills somewhere. Having serious FOMO.
Yes.
But Jeff Bridges joined a year ago. He's been front and center on the hunger cause for a really long time, and he's going to join you in less than an hour, Jeff Bridges.
That sounds outstanding. We'll get to some text, set up the rest of the show. Bob Costas, as you mentioned, will join 5 o'clock then, 5:02.
Right after Jeff Bridges. Fantasy Football Training Camp is back at Treasure Island Resort and Casino. You can join Charch and the entire Fantasy Football Weekly crew in the Full Deck Ballroom. It's Friday, August 16th from 6 to 9 p.m. The live broadcast is from 6 to 8. Then stick around for the Fantasy Football Deep Dive. Great prizes to be had, including a $1,000 grand prize. All the details now at KFAN.com, keyword calendar.
We talked a decent amount about the dude character last time we had Jeff Bridges on. But if you got some other ideas, you know, other directions, questions you might have for Jeff Bridges, who now is, according to Guardsy, confirmed to join us at, what'd you say, about 4:30?
Right around there, yep.
Hit the Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line, which is 646-86. We had a couple texts. We talked about Joe Mauer early, and the piece that we've discussed from time to time before, that part of, I think, what hurt Joe in terms of having this sort of mythic affection from fans here, and by the way, there's a great deal of affection because he's one of us, we get all that, is the lack of postseason success, right? I mean, we never won a series. Did we win any games? I don't even think we won any games when Joe played. Now, that wasn't on him.
I'd say, when did he come up? I bet 04, he was probably on the team. I think we won one game in 04.
Let me get his stats.
Maybe 03.
Now, do I lose him? Yeah.
Because 02 was still Przinski. And then we won the first game at Yankee Stadium in whatever series that was. I think that was 2003 or 2004. I feel like he would have been on the squad for at least one of those. Just trying to think out loud as you go to a completely different pile there. But we did not win any games after 2004. So whatever playoff appearances he was a part of then, we did not win any games.
2006 there. Was his first
playoff series against Oakland then. So he wasn't on the Twins team that beat the Yankees in game one. In like 2003 or 2004.
I don't think so, no.
Okay.
But we'll double check it. But what I have here is 06 was his first, and it was three games in 06, three games in 09, three games in 10, one game in 17.
Wow.
That's it. So, again, I'm not, this isn't to put it on him, like that's the reason they lost. But once again, if that's all you do in the postseason, there's not a lot of mythic stuff that can be associated with it as well. I got a text earlier when we had Tony on. See if I can find it. Here we go. Let me know when you get Tony D, the Trump supporter, off the phone, and I'd be happy to come back and listen to the show. And he texted a little later. I was legit excited to hear your take on what happened over the weekend politically, and then you blindside me with Tony Dungy. 612 guy, I don't even know what to say sometimes. I just end up being gobsmacked. I don't know what you think our obligation is. You obviously don't have to listen to anybody. But the idea that it's a blindside to get Tony Dungy on, which we've done certainly the last couple years in conjunction with this event, have the opportunity to do it, that we're not going to do it because you don't like his political affiliation. We're not doing that kind of show. I'm sorry. Maybe you think we should. anybody who's ever expressed support for Donald J. Trump, and I don't even know what Dungy's level of support is. I don't know any of it, to be honest, in his case. It seems a little frightening to me in a free country that would be your assumption that we can't, they're banned, can't have them on, because it triggers something like that in you. I'd say you got to grow up a little bit. And so I can't help you. There's already a couple of people saying, well, yeah, but Costas will be, yeah, well, we're going to get some political lectures from him too. So what? Are we that frightened? Are we that?
We're soft.
We are. That's the thing. I mean, we have become, a lot of times people who talk about, you know, mocking and ridiculing snowflakes have become snowflakes. You're going to curl up in the fetal position because Tony Dungy's on to talk, and largely what we talked about today was football. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I honestly had reached a point on Joe Biden, the other Joe, today, that I thought there was a decent chance he was going to say, screw it, I'm staying. Now, was it? There's a billion theories out there. In fact, one of the most interesting theories that advanced the notion that he's in for good was Barack Obama being one of the individuals telling him or leading the charge to try to convince him or put the pressure on him to you know, not run again in the fall. And the theory was it's the worst person to get on Joe Biden's jock in this regard, that there's still bad blood from the Biden folks basically saying when Hillary ran, Joe, it's not your turn. It's Hillary's turn. Don't think about it. Don't do it, whatever the case may be. And that there's always been some tension
really?
In that regard. And that was one of the reasons, just out of that ego clash.
Speaking of soft.
That he might not step aside. But again, it seems preposterous, but go through history. The number of times people in important positions have made a call for what might be called a frivolous or, you know, selfish reason. I think we could fill up a lot of history books with it. It's not that unusual. Was it the money drying up? Was that, who knows what exactly took place here? I'm not sure. But in the end, I had almost become convinced that he's just going to hang with this thing and that eventually the Democrats would coalesce around him, even those who said, well, he really needs to move on. Because why? Because we don't want the other guy. And so if he's going to stay, we can't force him out, right? We can't just get rid of him. Can you find the bumper-to-bumper seal of approval for me? Because it does fit into this discussion well.
It's the bumper-to-bumper seal of approval.
It's got to go to Dean Phillips again. And he's become a very popular interview lately, and I've seen him on some shows, not so much others. A couple national shows over the weekend. And I think Dean Phillips can say with a straight face, whatever you think of him politically, that he's the only guy who has the high ground here. Because there's a sticky wicket for the Democrats, right? For many of them. And there'll be an attempt by the Republicans to exploit this. And that is, oh, you want him out now? I see. Well, why do you want him out? Oh, you tell me it's because you think there are signs that he might not be up to the job for the next 4 years. There might be some mental acuity issues that are starting to accumulate. Timing's interesting. Because the polls would say you're doing it for another reason. That you want to take away all the votes that he accumulated through the primary process. Because you're worried about getting your ass kicked. Now, that's also not unprecedented in politics, but it is pretty hard for some Democrats to pretend they're taking some kind of a high road here at this point, right? with the exception of Dean Phillips. Because Phillips can say with a straight face before the primaries or as the primaries are starting, this is about mental acuity. Go back to the quote. This is in January. And he's talking about, you know, the advanced age of Joe Biden. At that stage of life, it is impossible ultimately to prosecute the office of the American presidency in the way that this country in the world needs right now. That is an absolute truth. When he Phillips ended his campaign in March, he was on with Hartman on CCO. While he thinks Biden is at a stage in life where his capacities are diminished, he is still a man of competency and decency and integrity. And the alternative is Donald Trump is a very dangerous, dangerous man. But at least he could say with a straight face, when I got into this before anybody else was willing to go public, I was not talking about votes. Now, in the back of his mind, he may have thought it was going to be a difficult election for Biden to be reelected this time around. But it was about the place Joe Biden was mentally, right? It is a little disingenuous, is it not, of some Democrats to pretend that, well, this is not about the votes, not about the situation. It's about how he is handling the position at this point. Now, the comeback to that could be you link the two. You may think he's got the acuity to pull it off, but if the perception is he can't, and that affects our ability to win, it affects our ability to win. But it does, and the Phillips, again, yesterday, I retweeted. Phillips is, and he's not going to be listened to again. On Harris being anointed, he says, I kind of agree with President Obama, former President Obama, who was much more generic, basically said, I trust the process.
Yep.
Like me and Jim Harbaugh trust the process, and there'll be some fine candidates, and let's just let the thing play out. And Phillips, I heard him yesterday. You know, let's not make this a coronation. We don't need to make this a coronation. And by the way, he praised Harris highly. He wasn't ripping her. But they're not listening, right? It's happening again. Again, if you're the Democrats, I get the bit. You want to be unified. But I have said this consistently before this decision was made. Harris is not owed the Democratic presidential bid, period, full stop for me. She's not. There are people who are afraid to say that because they're afraid in some cases they'll be viewed as, well, what? Oh, black woman, I see. Okay, that's interesting. Have you said that before? Yeah, I'll say it forever. You go back to everybody's doing the historical precedent, 1968, when LBJ says, I'm out. Not going to run for re-election. Hubert Humphrey wasn't anointed. He had to compete. Now, that happened a lot earlier, so there was a primary process, a regular primary process that took place, and ultimately Humphrey got the nomination. But there wasn't this sense of, well, he's owed it. He's got a leg up for all the obvious reasons in the administration. That could be good or bad. At the time, it may have been more bad than good because then he couldn't disengage himself from LBJ's albatross of Vietnam War. And you could argue again, the party to that extent was a lot less unified than it is now. There's not any one single issue that is fracturing the party like the Vietnam War did then. But who's to say what? Why? And here's the other thing that doesn't make any sense to me. Read the stories that have been written and what Democrats have said, some publicly, but more privately, about the vice president. And what do you hear? Well, boy, I'm not even sure, you know, if Joe's going to run again, maybe they'd be better off with somebody else in the VP role. Haven't been necessarily impressed. Some of her word salad, press conferences, but just speeches she makes, they are too easily made fun of. And by the way, there's probably an inherent unfairness to that because a lot of vice presidents get made fun of.
Sure,
but
yes.
But the idea that we've gone from, I have some legitimate questions here, really. I mean, her presidential bid had like a minute when she dressed down Biden, right? And that was it. Yep. After that, I mean, she collapsed.
That had to do
she
with the busing nothing. Thing yes, in the South, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although I think there ended up being more to the story, but it was a good moment.
It was a good moment.
But that was it.
Yep.
So the idea that now it's, who better? There's nobody better out there, that there can't be any questions about that? It doesn't make any sense. Meanwhile, the Republicans are frauds because they're now saying, you talk about the Jan 6 insurrection. This is an insurrection. You guys held Joe Biden hostage at gunpoint, and you said, Joe, you have to go. Even though millions and millions of Democrats voted for him in the process. What, by the way, have many of those same Republicans said for the last 6 months? Not up for the job. He's not up to the job. His mind isn't all there. Sleepy Joe. You don't even know what city he's in. But now it's convenient to turn this into a coup insurrection allegation. Why? Because they want it. Because those same Republicans who have for months said, this situation is dangerous in the White House. This guy doesn't even know what he's doing. They now want to run again. They want Trump to run against him because they think that's their best chance to win again, right? Is that also a bit of a contradiction?
There's a lot of contradictions all over the place right
politics
now.
Right now. By the way,
just from the last, 2 weeks.
Yes. Well, there was another one today. They had the hearing, or at least one of the hearings, with the head of the Secret Service. A couple thoughts on what I at least saw early. Maybe it got better. I hope it got better. What I saw was us, all of us, politically speaking, Republicans, Democrats, and the individual being interviewed or testifying at our very worst. Stay tuned.